Every good project needs to have a start, and this video is the first in the platform bed that we're going to be building. And I'm going to be starting with what I'm lovingly referring to as the undercarriage.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop, sponsored by Lee Valley and Veritas. With over 5,000 high-quality woodworking hand tools, visit their online catalog at leevalley.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop, and as I mentioned at the beginning of the show, this is the first of a multiple part series on the construction of this platform bed that I'm building for my son Aiden. So as you can see in the SketchUp drawing, this is a really, I think it's a nice design. It's one of the most contemporary pieces I think I've made yet. So this is definitely a stretch for me, but it is a really, I love the design overall. It's really simple and it seems to be exactly what would fit perfectly into his room. Now, the majority of the project is going to be made from solid maple. The only part that isn't is going to be this portion, and we can see in this exploded diagram here on the SketchUp drawing that this is the portion I'm referring to as the undercarriage. And this is going to be made from a secondary wood. More specifically, I'm going to be using poplar. Main reason for using it is, well, number one, poplar is inexpensive compared to maple, at least in my neck of the woods, but it's still just as strong. And on top of it, it's kind of being hidden away. The majority of it will be kind of tucked underneath the mattress. That's going to be tucked with inside of a maple box and everything. So I really didn't see why I should spend extra money on the maple when I could easily get the same thing done with this poplar and save myself a few extra dollars. So that's the main reason for it. But anyways, though, let's go ahead and let's just get jumped right in here and start talking about the construction of this undercarriage area here. Really, when it comes down to it, it's just a frame, more or less. And so the first thing I did, of course, is I need to mill up my rough stock. And whenever I do this, I just want to kind of run over this real quick in case you're not familiar with taking care of roughing out your material. I like to do mine to rough length, so there's a little extra in there. So I will measure these out, give myself a little extra inch or two at each end, and the same thing with the actual width itself. Then what I do is I will cross cut it to the shorter lengths. I like to work with my material, not in these big wide boards and do all of the milling from there. I like to take them down closer to the size of the components simply because it works with my machinery easier. Sure, it adds a little extra time to the milling process, but it works for me. So once I get it cross cut with my handsaw, I then move over to the bandsaw, which will again helps me to rip it into the smaller positions. I can then move to my jointer, and I will talk a little bit more about the jointer later on because there was some challenges with the extra long pieces. I ended up having to put a roller stand to help me kind of balance things out a little bit to give me the little extra balance I needed to make sure that the pieces turned out the way I wanted to. Then took it to my thickness planer, came back over here to the table saw, and started taking everything down to its finished dimensions, including cross-cutting, which if you've seen the most recent Matt's Basement Workshop shorts, then you maybe saw a new technique that I was trying out when it came to the cross cutting. I invite you to check that out versus me talking about it right now. But what I do want to do is let's get into cutting the joints that we need for these finished pieces for the undercarriage. And the way that I am assembling these is I'm going to be using what's referred to as a corner lap. Now, you might refer to it as a half lap. I know in a segment that I did earlier in the week when I was actually creating the joinery, I referred to it as a half lap, but I turned to a book that I have recommended before in the past. It's called Classic Joints with Power Tools by Yeung Chan, and he has a whole section in here about creating half laps, ship laps, corner laps, all sorts of different ones. And we have options when it comes to creating this joinery. We don't have to use just one machinery. I chose to use the table saw simply because it works best for me. I really like the way that I'm doing it on this. I feel more comfortable with it, but we can accomplish this with our routers. We can accomplish this with our bandsaws. We have just all sorts of various options. So anyways, though, the reason why I chose to go with the corner lap is when I get this in position, I have one shoulder on each board, which is going to help, number one, to kind of align things up. Number two, it's going to add some rigidity and strength. And number three, we have a really large long grain to long grain joint here. Even if I'm going to be actually be going, you know, one grain in one direction and the other grain going in a completely different direction, going perpendicular to it, it still is a long grain to long grain joint, and it's going to work out perfectly fine. In fact, it's going to give me a lot of strength One thing that Yeung Chan did mention in his book is with wider boards, these are 4 inches. We are going to be a little bit concerned about wood movement. But just for the record, as I'm constructing this, this is the most humid portion of the season in my shop. So all my boards are pretty much at their the widest they're normally going to get within this type of environment. So I'm not really too worried about it. They maybe might shrink a little bit. So what I'll end up doing is when I glue these in position, I'll actually come back in and maybe put some sort of mechanical fastener in there, whether it's a dowel or something, to help reinforce it and give it just a little extra strength. But there'll be more about that as we start to actually assemble the bed. So with that said, let's take a look at the footage that I shot earlier when I was creating these corner laps here at the table saw. All right, so over here at the table saw, I've got everything set up to do the lap joints. And I just want to explain my setup real quick in case you're wondering why I'm doing it this way. Now, you saw me before cut these longer pieces on my crosscut sled, and I could easily adapt that crosscut sled to be used with my stacked dado, but in this situation, I just don't feel like doing it right now. I want to leave it the way it is. And the vast majority of the time, using something as simple as just this miter gauge with a sacrificial fence on it works out perfectly fine. And this is one of those situations where it does work that well. Now, I know that because this material is approximately 4 inches, I want to go ahead and make a mark back from the end, 4 inches, and then I can go ahead and register it up against where that dado has already gone through, and then I can just start nibbling away at the material. Of course, again, because this is a longer board, I want to have support on the end here, because if I didn't, there's a very good potential that as I feed this out to get these end pieces, it'll start getting a little tippy on me. Not really too much, but I just don't want to take a chance. So I went ahead and I just set up a roller stand over here. And this is a really nice one because it has these nice ball bearing options on it. It has 3 different heads, but regardless of which one it is, the main thing is that I'm using some sort of support down there. Another thing that you'll see me do as we make these cuts is I have 2 sets of clamps here, and I'm just gonna clamp these into position. And to help make sure that the wood stays solid to the table, I'm going to use just a nice push block. In fact, I'm going to use this gripper because I like how it gets my hand up out of the way. And we'll just go ahead and push it through and we'll get the cuts that we want from this. And like I said, we'll start nibbling it and moving it all the way down. One thing I'm definitely going to recommend, because I've had a couple of panic moments so far, is when you go to flip this over to do the opposite end, because we're going to be doing both ends of these, do yourself a favor and mark the ends that are not to be cut. Whoa, hold on a second here. I need to clarify something. When I mentioned making the mark, what I really meant was mark the areas that you want to have the material removed. So that way, as you're doing it in the heat of actually making the joinery, you're not going to suddenly discover afterwards that you have one on one side and one on the opposite side, when in fact you wanted them both on the same faces. So anyways though, let's go ahead and continue. Because nothing is worse than getting through that first pass and suddenly panicking and thinking, wait a minute, am I on the right side? Thankfully, I was both times that I panicked. So anyway, so let's go ahead and make those cuts and get this started. And we'll show you what that lap joint looks like once we get it finished. All right, so I hope that made sense about creating the laps themselves, the corner laps here. Be the same thing if you're doing some sort of half lap. The next thing I want to do is, if we take again another look at the SketchUp drawing here, we see that we have this longer middle piece that is going to act as a support for the slats that are going to be going into this project. And I'm going to put them into the top and bottom rails via what's referred to as a half blind lap. And I went ahead because I already made the mistake of shooting this footage and forgetting to clear my SD chip, at least clear it enough so that I wouldn't lose footage. I already went ahead and I made the half blind laps themselves. It's a really easy process, but what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna recreate creating these half blind laps, and all I'm gonna use is a chisel, a mallet, and then my router plane. You could easily accomplish this with a router and say a nice hinge mortising bit, or perhaps some sort of straight cutting bit, anything that would hog out this material and give you a nice flat bottom. That's an option you have, but in my case, I really like to mix my power and hand tools just because I do. It's just as simple as that. So anyways, let's head over to the workbench and let's see that reenactment, because it's gonna be really good. Now, to create the half blind lap, I'm gonna go ahead and reference it off of this first part here, which this is one end of that long middle support. So let's go ahead, get this in position here. And normally what I would do is I'd mark exactly the center point of the rail and then this particular piece right here, so that way I can match them up. I'm then just gonna use a marking knife because I want a really nice tight line here. So I got everything in position, I just double check it. And I will come right along here and mark its location. Hopefully my hand's not getting too much in the way for this. If we have to, we'll just move the camera around. Anyways, though, so we get this marked out. We are now done with this middle support, so we'll get that out of the way. And then I went ahead and I took my marking gauge and I set it up for the depth that I want here. So I will just simply run it along the edge and get that mark that I need. Okay, it's there. And then just for the camera work, we'll go ahead and mark in these lines so that you can see it as we make our progress. Now, we're not gonna film the whole entire thing as we go along here, just because it's gonna be too long. This will take about 10, 15 minutes. But again, I enjoy the whole entire process. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna grab my chisel and I'm gonna get my mallet all set up too. And the first thing I wanna go along, and it's gonna be my widest chisel possible, and I'm just gonna drop it into that knife line and start registering the outline of this. I wanna sever those fibers. So I'm gonna go ahead and finish this and then I'll come back and we'll move on to the next portion. So at this point, I've gone around with the chisel and I've scored the first layer of fibers. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna turn the bevel over and I'm now gonna start further defining it. Again, doing this with a router would go a lot faster, but I just enjoy the process, so that's all that really matters. Okay, so there. And then I'll just go a little bit further. And what I end up having to do is dropping it back down to that knife line and score the next layer. Now, I could probably start getting really aggressive with my mallet and dropping it down even more, but for this purpose at the moment, we will just, there we go. All right, so maybe we'll flip it back over so we can get a little bit deeper. This chisel's getting maybe a little dull. All right, I'm gonna do the same thing going this direction. Again, not too deep, because I don't wanna mess anything up at this layer yet. Once this shoulder gets further defined, then we can really start chopping things. All right, so I'm gonna get this one more. All right, I'm gonna continue doing this. I'll come over here, do this side. And then once I have this ready to go, we'll start hogging out the rest of this. point. So as we get further across, I'm obviously being cautious not to keep on pounding because I don't want to tear into that shoulder. But at the same time, I want to really remove material here. So let's go a little bit more. All right, so this is what we've done after approximately, I'm going to say about 9-10 minutes of chopping. So we're going to go ahead and move to our router plane to start cleaning all of that out. Okay, so I've actually gone ahead and started doing a little work here with the router plane to get this in position. But essentially, what we're going to do is we want to smooth out this bottom, make it all nice and even as much as possible. It doesn't really take very long to get this taken care of. Actually, you know what? I need a little support on this side, so I'm going to put this in here. There we go. Oops. The main thing is not to tip it into, keep, if you notice, I tip a little once in a while. But anyways, so we almost got this done. I have these two knurled nuts on here, and they are actually kind of acting as my stop gauge, so I know exactly when I'm down to the appropriate depth, and it looks like I've reached it. So this should be our last pass in here. I'd like to make this as dead flat as possible, but I think I might have done a little too much chisel work. But it's no big deal because, as you can hear, we're making contact in here. So we're going to have a nice reference face for the other part of this joint. All right, let's get some of this out of here. There we go. All right, let's just turn it around. And let's take our chisel and just clean up these edges real quick here. All right, there we go. It is all set. All right, folks, so that's pretty much going to do it for today's episode. We have our corner laps done. We have our half-blind laps all taken care of here. The only thing left on the undercarriage that we might need to take care of, so I know I've got a couple of little slats here that will help to add a little extra support for this middle piece, and then the slats themselves, but that's literally just ripping a couple of boards and cross-cutting them, so not too much to see there. If you're interested again in that book that I was referring to that has all the great information about the joinery, not just how to do it on the table saw, but all the various power tools, it's Classic Joints with Power Tools by Yeung Chan, and it is a really, really good book. I love it. I've turned to it for so many different options. In fact, it could almost be too much information if you're not careful. But anyways, though, so I'm going to take this apart. I'm going to set it aside. I'm not going to glue it up quite yet, but when we do, we'll make sure to reinforce those corner joints. And if you have comments, questions, suggestions, please, you know how to contact me. It's at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com, or you can leave a comment in the show notes over at my website at mattsbasementworkshop.com. You can even leave a comment in the YouTube page if that happens to be where you are watching this. I love hearing from all of you. And one thing I know some of you will be asking, will I be releasing the SketchUp drawing of this? And I'm going to wait until the whole thing is constructed, so that way any tweaks I have to make, because I'm finding I'm making a few of them here and there, that way they're all taken care of and we have it all wrapped up as one big project. But anyway, so more about that as we get to the end. The next thing I'm going to be doing is ripping some maple to start building that box around this. And we'll be doing that probably in the next episode. So until then, straight grains and sharp blades. Thanks for stopping by.
Thanks for watching. To find even more videos and woodworking-related content, be sure to visit our website at mattsbasementworkshop.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Google+. And don't forget to subscribe to the show either on YouTube, in iTunes, or you can even receive email notifications whenever we post something new.